Hello, welcome to session 12 in this online course taking you through George Spencer Brown's Laws of Form. I'm Leon Conrad, and in this session we're going to wrap up the content Spencer Brown's outlines at the end of chapter 8, which brings everything together. The first thing I'd like to share with you is his thoughts on content, image and reflection. Any expression E, he says, can be considered with E as being the content, E mark being the image, and E mark over mark being the reflection. And since E mark over mark is equivalent to E, then the act of reflection is a return from an image to its content, or from a content to its image. And that, I suggest, is something well worth reflecting on. Now, suppose E is a cross. Where's the content? It's not the content that is below the cross, it's the content of the whole space in which the cross stands, in which it marks. And that is inside the boundary surrounding the mark, the space, which shapes another form. There's always a space beyond. So we are in that space with the expression, and we are all surrounded by the unwritten cross. And what he says is, if a property is common to every indication, it doesn't need to be indicated. In fact, it cannot be indicated, he said in a very notable footnote. Every attempted indication of it would be devoid of meaning. And here he quotes J.M. Robertson, one of his favourite authors, in a book, Letters on Reasoning, which he read when he was a school child and kept reading throughout his life. Towards the end of his life, when he was in a nursing home, I sent him a large printout of this book, and he derived great joy from revisiting the wording in this book. And he quoted Robertson, what he called Robertson's first dictum, on a number of occasions. It goes, "There can be no rational ascription of single mode to the totality of things." And this is how the quote appears in context. Robertson's book is available for free on archive.org. It's a series of letters about reasoning and clear reasoning and how to live well that he wrote for his children when they were young, hoping that they would read it when they grew up. And the things that Spencer Brown say are common to every indication and need not be indicated are two. Firstly, an unwritten cross, and secondly, a recessive value. Now, non-mathematicians, he says, have attributed some deep philosophical meaning to the unwritten cross, but it is merely a device to collect the whole expression into one bracket. Now, we're going to move towards simplifying expressions using different techniques. The first is just going to use I1 and I2. Condense and cancel. The expression we're going to use is just constructed of marks. So it's pretty simple. We take the first pair of nested marks, cancel them, do that with the second pair, we condense, and we're left with the marked state. We've done this before. It's very simple. Now, as soon as we add in variables, we have to go to the arithmetic. We can use the calculus, but he wants to demonstrate that we can just use the arithmetical theorems. To do this, we're going to call the left-hand part of the equation x, the right-hand y, and we're going to substitute a for a mark in x. We're going to cancel out the pair of nested marks by I2, remember? Then, we're going to move the B mark over to its equivalent partition, which we can do because that has a blank mark, an empty mark in it. And anything next to it is something that can just get crossed out. So if we put it there, it's as if it isn't there. And that holds by the rule of equivalence, our old Einstein equation. So our expression looks like this now. This allows us to see that there are two divisions with a common mark, and we can apply, in this case, T9, which is exactly the same as J2, and we get this expression. Anything next to an empty mark gets cancelled, and so, by this theorem, the expression looks like this. We cancel by I2, which looks like this twice, and we're left with a B mark. So when A is a marked state, X equals B mark. Let's substitute a mark for A in expression Y. In this state, we take away anything next to an empty cross by T2. We cancel out the pair of nested marks by I2. And Y equals B cross. So where A is equivalent to a marked state, X equals Y by T7. Now what happens when A is an unmarked state? Well, we take it out of X, we move C to the left, C mark to the left, because it's got an empty cross on the left, by these two theorems. Then we do the same thing, we use our T9, which is the equivalent of J2. We remove anything that's next to an empty cross by T2, and we cancel the pairs of nested marks by I2. So X equals C mark. Now what happens when we substitute in Y? We remove the A's, we take out anything that's next to an empty cross by T2, and remove by I2, and Y equals C mark. Where A is equal to an unmarked state, both X and Y are equivalent to C mark, therefore X equals Y by our Einstein theorem. No other case. There are only two options that are possible, and those are the only options, so X equals Y. And that's a proof using only the arithmetic. Now we're going to take exactly the same equation and use the canons of algebra. And you'll see how much faster and quicker this is. Again, we're substituting a mark for A in expression X and taking away the pair of nested marks, C1, taking away anything that's next to an empty cross by C3, removing the pairs of nested marks by C1, and we get to B mark. Substituting in Y, we remove what's next to an empty cross, we cancel nested marks, and we're left with B mark. So X and Y are equivalent. If we remove A, because we assign it a value of an unmarked state from X, remove anything next to an empty mark by C3, remove the nested pairs of marks by C1, we're left with C mark for the value of X. If we remove A from Y, then we are left with something that we can remove beside an empty cross, with a pair of nested marks which we can cancel, and we're left with C mark, so X equals Y in this instance. If expressions are equivalent in every case of one variable, he says they're equivalent. This is Theorem 16, which is the bridge I've been talking about, which takes us to the equations of the second order. Now, you have to imagine a variable oscillating between marked and unmarked states, and this is where a printed version of the book falls short. You have to think in a different way from here on. Now, in an unmarked state, it'll be seen to flicker. It'll be seen to change. And that is a change in the value of the boundary between that space and the space above. But if it's in a marked space, you won't see a change, because if it's a mark, the marks will condense. If it's an unmarked state, it won't appear. So there'll always be a mark. In this theorem, he introduces new terms: transparent, opaque, and he introduces them in relation to the word oscillation. Imagine you've got an oscillating variable V. It can be placed inside a mark, it can be placed outside a mark, or it can stand alone. If it is inside a mark or it stands alone, it will be transparent. You'll be able to see it. If it stands outside a mark, it will be opaque. Now imagine an oscillating variable B in spaces E and F, both being opaque to V. So you could have this oscillating variable anywhere, you just don't see it. Now, if there's a change in V and E and F are still equivalent, then they were equivalent before. E equals F under this condition. Now imagine that you have this oscillating variable in spaces E and F. Both are transparent. If there's a change in V and both spaces are equivalent, then they will have been equivalent before the change. E equals F under this condition. So E equals F under any condition, and hence in any case. This completes the proof. This allows him to introduce variables, oscillating variables, into a finite expression and play with that idea. And that's what we're going to start looking at in Theorem 17 in our next session. Join me then.